فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله الذي جعل الحج مقاما للتعليم ووفق فيه من شاء من عباده إلى الدين القويم، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما علم الحجاج، وعلى آله وصحبه خيرة وفد الحاج. أما بعد، then إن شاء الله تعالى we'll be going through the book التحقيق والإيضاح لكثير من مسائل الحج والعمرة للشيخ العلامة عبد العزيز بن عبد الله بن باز رحمه الله تعالى. And this is our third lesson in the book. And on Wednesday, there was a miscommunication between me and Ustaz Abdul Rahman, and I did actually come. I came, but no one was here. فلا بأس, no problem, inshallah. But it wasn't cancelled. I didn't cancel the lesson, and it was just a miscommunication. So the Sheikh, so in this part, and inshallah ta'ala, this may be our last lesson if we're able to finish it. If not, we'll carry on tomorrow, inshallah. And in this, we've spoken about everything that a person does before entering Mecca, and which that is the mawaqit and the ihram and the things that are haram for the person who's in the state of ihram. And these things, inshallah ta'ala, in this lesson, we're going to be talking about what a person does when they enter into Mecca, and also the second part will be what a person does when on the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, which is called Yawm al-Tarwiyah, the day of Tarwiyah, which is the day that the Hajj actually starts. So before we start into that, we have to go through a few points that you should write down and you should know for this. And this is something, these are the arkan and the wajibat of Hajj, the pillars, and also the wajibat of Hajj. So we start off with the pillars of Hajj. Meaning, and a pillar is something that is part of an act of ibadah. Yani it is part of the ibadah, and the ibadah is not complete except with it. This is a pillar in all of the, when you learn about fiqh, you learn about al-rukn, our pillar. And a pillar is something that it is part of the ibadah as opposed to a condition, because a condition is outside the ibadah and it's not part of the ibadah. That's the difference between a pillar and a condition, shart and al-rukn. So the arkan of Hajj, the pillars of Hajj are four or five, depending on how you classify it. And so the pillars of Hajj, number one is al-ihram, just to go into the state of ihram. Al-ihram, to be in the state of ihram. That's the first pillar of Hajj. Meaning if a person now does Hajj without going into the state of ihram, then his Hajj is invalid. And if, that's the pillar. And then we're going to go to the wajibat. There's a point that we have to make about this ihram when we come to the wajibat. Number two is al-wukuf, يعني bi-arafah, standing at Arafah. Standing at Arafah, which is on the 9th day of Dhul Hijjah. Al-wukuf bi-arafah. And number three is tawaf al-ifadah. Al-tawaf, basically. And it's called tawaf al-ifadah. And it's also called tawaf al-ziyarah. This is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلْيَطَّوَّفُوا بِالْبَيْتِ الْعَتِيقِ. You have to do tawaf. And number four is السعي, which is between Safa and Marwa. Going between Safa and Marwa. And this is also, they call it سعي والإفاضة as well. But this is سعي. Those are the four arkan of Hajj. And Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala mentions in his Al-Minhaj that Al-Halq as well. Shaving the head, shaving or cutting or taqseer, al-halq or taqseer, meaning shaving or shooting in the hair. And this is how a person leaves the state of ihram. So this is number five. And the wajibat of al-hajj, the wajibat, meaning a wajib of hajj is something that you have to do. And if a person leaves this thing, then they have to pay a fidya, a penalty. So if you leave any of one of these things, then you have to pay a penalty, and there are eight. If a person leaves any one of these, they have to pay a penalty. Wajibat al-hajj, al-ihram min al-miqat. Notice how we said this wajib is to do ihram from the miqat. And the miqat, we spoke about it, right? It's the places around Mecca where a person cannot pass except in the state of ihram if he wants to do hajj or umrah. So you have to, now the ihram has to be done before the, you can't pass the miqat before that. It is wajib, the wajib that we're talking about here, number one, is to go to be in the state of ihram before passing the miqat. And the difference between this, the wajib and the rukun, is what? That we said the rukun, the pillar, is ihram. Meaning if a person does ihram after the miqat, he still has completed the pillar, but he hasn't completed the wajib. So his hajj is still correct, but he has to pay a fidya. You understand? You understand that? The difference between the pillar of the first rukun and the first wajib. That if a person now, they do hajj without ihram at all, which is niyatul dukhul fi nusuk, the intention to enter into the rituals of hajj. If you now come to hajj without the intention of ihram, your hajj is null and void. Your hajj is null and void. But if a person now does ihram from after the miqat, he passes the miqat and he does ihram in Mecca, for example, his hajj is still valid, but he's missed the wajib. Therefore, he has to pay a fidya, he has to pay a penalty. You understand that? It's difference. So it's rukun is a pillar to be in the state of ihram, and it is wajib, it's obligatory to be in the state of ihram before you enter into Mecca, before you have to do at the miqat. Number two, the second wajib is al-wuqufu ila al-ghurub. And this is again similar to this point. You have to be standing at Arafah until ghurub al-shams, until al-maghrib, to the time the sun sets. Standing at Arafah until the sun sets. So what's the difference between the pillar and the wajib here? The pillar, we said you have to stand at Arafah, and the wajib, you have to stand until ghurub, until maghrib. What's the difference? Yes. You just have to do it. So the difference is that if a person stands at Arafah and he gets into Arafah at Asr time, for example, and he stands there and he leaves 10 minutes later, he doesn't wait until sunset. This person has completed his hajj is correct. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Hajj Arafah. Hajj is Arafah. If a person doesn't go to Arafah at all in the day or night, then his hajj is completely invalid. But if he goes into Arafah for even 10 minutes, then his hajj is valid, but he has to pay a fidya. That's the difference. So he has to stay until Maghrib. If he doesn't stay until Maghrib, then his hajj is correct, but he has to pay a fidya. If he doesn't stand at Arafah at all, not on the day of Arafah, the ninth day of Dhul Hijjah, nor at night of that same night, because they allow also standing at night if a person who can't stand in the daytime. If he doesn't do that at all, he doesn't go to Arafah, he doesn't fly past Arafah. You know, if you fly past Arafah, it's okay. If you don't go on a helicopter past Arafah, if you don't go to Arafah, then your hajj is invalid completely. You have to do another hajj. Your hajj is gone. You understand? That's the difference between the rukun and the wajib, the pillar and the obligatory act. Huh?
So could you go just before maghrib and just stand?
No, you can do that. You can stand just before even, but you have to stay until maghrib. I mean, once you enter it, you have to stay until maghrib. You can't leave. Now, number three is مبيت ليالي التشريق بمنى. You have to stay in Mina on the nights of Tashriq, which is the 11th, 12th, and 13th of Dhul Hijjah. Except that a person, if they're allowed to do only 2 days, 11 and 12, if they leave before Maghrib. Meaning, now we finished, you come back from Yawm al-Nahr, you finished throwing Jamarat, you done your Tawaf and stuff, and you come back, you have to stay in Mina, Ayyam al-Tashriq. These are days of the 3 days that, you know, a lot of people, they know Eid al-Adha to be 3 days, right? And this is called Ayyam al-Tashriq. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about them, Ayyam al-Tashriq, Ayyam al-Akli, wa-shurb, wa-dhikri lillah. It are days of eating and drinking and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Mina, for the Hujjaj in the Mina, and they stay there. So a person, he has to stay in Mina on the 11th day in the camps, and on the 12th day of the Hujjah, and on the 13th day for the person who doesn't leave early. Because there's a choice for a person to leave early. Allah says, الحج أشهر أيام معدودات فمن تعجل في يومين فلا إثم عليه ومن تأخر فلا إثم عليه لمن اتقى. He says that the person who wants to leave after 2 days, meaning the 11th and the 12th, and then they leave, then there's no problem. And the person who leaves on after the 13th, then there's no problem as well. And staying for the 13th is better, because that's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam done. So that's what we mean. You have to stay in Mina at night, al-mabit. Stay at night in Mina on the 11th, 12th, and 13th day. If a person now wants to leave early, on the 12th day, they have to leave before Maghrib. Meaning, you stay the 11th day, you slept, you woke up. On the 12th day, you slept, you went, you stoned the Jamarat after Zawal, and you waited until Maghrib time. If you don't leave until Maghrib, meaning if you don't pack up your stuff and try to leave Mina before Maghrib, then you have to stay the next day, the 13th. If you don't stay on the next night, then you have to pay a fidya. This is because you missed a wajib. If you don't leave by Maghrib time, you understand? You have to leave by Maghrib. And I told you again, a lot of these things might go over your head because you might not have done Hajj. And a person, you know, these rulings, when you do Hajj, it's going to come to your head, inshallah. Because as I said to you, one of my teachers, they said to me, you'll never understand Hajj properly until you do Hajj. So in these points, you might be, you know, and you won't understand it properly. But inshallah, when you do Hajj, you understand it properly. And number four is Al-Mabitu bi Muzdalifa. You have to stay in Muzdalifa at night. And that is on the after the day of Arafah. So on the 10th night of Dhul Hijjah. The 10th night of Dhul Hijjah, when Maghrib comes, after you just finished Arafah, you go to Muzdalifa and you have to stay there. And this is a wajib. If a person doesn't do it, then they have to pay fidya. And according to some scholars, they say it is a rukun, a pillar as well. According to some. Like when we say it's a wajib. Wallahu a'lam. And number five, Ar-Ramyu Murattaba. One of the things that you have to do in Hajj is you have to throw rocks at the jamarat. You have to throw stones at the jamarat. And you have to do it in order. This is wajib. You have to do the jamarat al-sughra, al-kubra, al-aqaba. The small one, and then the medium one, and then al-aqaba, the large one. You have to do it in that order. And they are put in order. So if you go there, you'll see it's in order. And you can't do it in a different order. Al-halqa wa-taqseer. And this is to shave or to shorten the hair. And this is according to those who make it as a wajib. So some make it as a wajib, and some make it as a pillar as well, just like Muzdalifa. And number seven, al-wada', tawaf al-wada', which is the tawaf that a person does before they leave Mecca. When you leave Mecca and you finished doing your Hajj, then you have to do tawaf al-wada'. And this is for a person who's doing Hajj specifically. As for a person who's doing Umrah, then there's a difference of opinion whether they have to do tawaf al-wada' or not. But if a person is doing Hajj, then they have to do tawaf al-wada', which is the tawaf that you do before you're leaving Mecca. And number eight is al-dhabhu lil-qari wa al-mutamatti'. Slaughtering, which is slaughtering a sheep, or sub'u badana, 1/7 of a camel, or 1/7 of a cow, for a person who's doing al-qiran or mutamatti'. I remember we learned what is qiran and mutamatti', the three types of Hajj, right? There's qiran and there's tamatti', and there's ifrad. So a person who's in this, who's qarin or mutamatti', they have to do dhabh, they have to slaughter. And if they cannot slaughter, then they fast 3 days and seven in Mecca before the days of Arafah preferably, and 7 days when they go back to their family after they finished. Because Allah says, فَثَلَاثَةٌ فِي الْحَجِّ وَسَبْعَةٌ إِذَا رَجَعْتُمْ تِلْكَ عَشَرَةٌ كَامِلَةٌ. So those are the wajibat and the arkan of Hajj. So Shaykh Rahimahullah Ta'ala now says, now based on this we're going to read what we're going to go through, because now he's going to go through what a person does when he enters into Mecca and he starts his Hajj. So he says, فَصْلٌ فِي مَا يَفْعَلُهُ الْحَجُّ عِنْدِ دُخُولِهِ مَكَّةِ. So this chapter, this fasal is talking about what a person does when they first enter into Mecca. And a person who enters into Mecca has three states. Either he's going to be qarin, or mutamatti', or mufrid. He's going to be in one of these states. He's either going to do, his Hajj is going to be al-qiran, or al-tamattu', or al-ifrad. It's going to be one of these three states. A person now who's in the state of all of these people, they have to do something called tawaf al-qudum, which is the tawaf for a person who comes into Mecca first. And the person who comes, so we'll read it first and then we're going to explain inshallah. It says, فَإِذَا وَصَلَ الْمُحْرِمُ إِلَى مَكَّةَ تَسْتُحِبَّ لَهُ وَيَغْتَسِلَ قَبْلَ دُخُولِهَا لِأَنَّ النَّبِيَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَعَلَ ذَلِكَ فَإِذَا وَصَلَ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ سُنَّ لَهُ تَقْدِيمَ رِجْلَهُ الْيُمْنَى وَيَقُولُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ وَالصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ الْعَظِيمِ وَبِوَجْهِهِ الْكَرِيمِ وَسُلْطَانِهِ الْعَظِيمِ الْقَدِيمِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ اللَّهُمَّ افْتَحْ لِي أَبْوَابَ رَحْمَتِكَ وَيَقُولُ ذَلِكَ عِنْدَ دُخُولِ سَائِرِ الْمَسَاجِدِ وَلَيْسَ لِدُخُولِ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ ذِكْرٌ مَخْصُوصٌ يخصه ثابت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما أعلم. So when a person comes into Mecca now, they are in a state of, they're going to do tawaf. And every single, all of these three people who are going to do into Mecca, they're going to be doing tawaf, whether it be for Umrah or whether it be for Al-Qudum only. So the Mutamatti and the Qarin is going to be doing it for Umrah and Qudum. And the Mufrid is going to be doing it for Qudum only, meaning for entering into Mecca. Al-Qudum, Tawaf al-Qudum, is the Tawaf that you do when you enter into Mecca. So now, the Shaykh Rahimahullah Ta'ala says he enters into the Masjid al-Haram with his right leg and he makes the dua, Allahumma bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, a'udhu billahi al-azim wa biwajhi al-kareem wa sultani al-qadim min ash-shaytani al-rajim, Allahumma aftah li abwaab rahmatik. Rawahu Abu Dawood. It's narrated by Abu Dawood bi isnadin qawi, with a strong chain of narration, as mentioned by Shaykh Salih al-Usaymi waffaqahu Allah Ta'ala. So, and this dua is for every single masjid. It's not necessarily for the Masjid al-Haram only specifically. So when this person enters, he is going to start doing his tawaf. And we're going to be talking about this tawaf is now mushtarak. Every single person who's going to do hajj, this, no matter what type of hajj they're doing, they're going to be doing this tawaf. So this person, he enters into tawaf, and the sunnah is to have something called al-ittiba, which is to have your ihram, your right shoulder exposed, and your ihram covering the other shoulder. So it's something called al-tiba'. Leave your right shoulder exposed. And you start from al-hajar al-aswad. And when a person sees the hajar al-aswad, when the person comes to sees the Kaaba, they stop the talbiyah. And you know, when a person from the miqat until Mecca, they're meant to be doing talbiyah, which is the saying, labbaik Allahumma labbaik. And this is something that a person should be doing. When they see the Kaaba, then they stop doing it. And this is narrated by Ibn Umar, that he will stop doing talbiyah when they see the Kaaba. And this is something that they do. So a person now does tawaf 7 times. And there is no specific dhikr that is mentioned in tawaf specifically, except for between Rukn al-Yamani and Hajar al-Aswad, you say, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابِ النَّارِ. Other than that, then there is no specific dua or dhikr that a person should do according to any narration narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there has been narrated that some of them say, Allahumma imanan bik wa tasdiqan bi kitabik wa wafa'an bi ahdik wa tiba'an li sunnati nabiyika Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This has been narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but it is weak. In fact, Ata' ibn Abi Rabah rahimahullahu ta'ala, one of the tabi'een, he said this is from the innovations of people of Iraq. The people who came from Iraq, they innovated this and they started doing it. Until today you find people doing this, making this dua. And Ata' said, this is an innovation from the people of Iraq. So a person can do any dua that he wants whilst doing tawaf. And it's narrated from different sahaba, that some of them used to say, Allahumma qini shuhha nafsi, oh Allah, protect me from the greed of my own self. And they asked him, why do you keep saying that? He keeps saying that around the tawaf. He said, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Whoever is protected from the greed of his own self, then he is the successful one. So some of them, they used to do that, they used to go around tawaf and doing that. And if you say, رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. And if you make dua, or if you read the Quran, there's no problem, a person is doing tawaf. And this tawaf, again we said, is tawaf al-qudum. And also for those people who are doing umrah, it is tawaf for their umrah as well. When a person finishes their tawaf, they go around the Kaaba 7 times, and when they get to the Hajar al-Aswad, the black stone, it is sunnah for a person to come and kiss the black stone. That's sunnah. And when they begin the tawaf, at the beginning they say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, whilst pointing to the black stone or kissing the black stone. If a person can't kiss the black stone, then they touch it and kiss their hand. And if they can't touch it and kiss the hand, then they use something to touch it. As the Prophet ﷺ used to do, he would use a stick and kiss the end of the stick. If you can't do that, then they go past the Hajar al-Aswad and you say Allahu Akbar with waving, and you don't kiss your hand. You don't kiss your hand. You understand? A lot of people, they kiss their hand and their eyes and stuff like that. This is not from the Sunnah. The Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is that you point at it like that and you say Allahu Akbar. Except in the first one, you say Bismillah Allahu Akbar. In the first one, you say Bismillah Allahu Akbar. And it is sunnah also for a person who is doing this tawaf. Again, we said to expose the right shoulder, which is called al-ittiba'. And it's also sunnah for him to do something called al-ramal. And al-ramal is to walk fast in the first 3 circuits of tawaf. To walk fast. And subhanAllah, the reason why people we do this is because when the Prophet ﷺ entered into Mecca, the mushrikeen, they said that in Medina, you know, there was an illness, al-humma. There was a flu and a fever that was in Medina generally. So you know, whoever enters into Medina, they will get that. So some of the companions, they did get ill, like Bilal. He got ill, radiallahu anhu, and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. They got very ill until they thought they were going to die. So the Prophet ﷺ made dua for this illness to leave Medina. So the illness was left from Medina. So the mushrikeen, when they heard that the Prophet ﷺ and his companions are coming to do Umrah, they said, these people are coming from a place where there's illness, so they're going to be ill and weak. So the Prophet ﷺ commanded his companions to uncover their shoulders and also to run, to walk fast in the first three circuits of Tawaf, to show the mushrikeen who were outside Mecca on a mountain called Jabal Abi Qubais, I think they were in Jabal Abi Qubais, and they were watching the Muslims doing Tawaf, and they said, look at these Muslims, they're still strong, they're not weak. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ done it. Why do we do it? لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. There's a good example for you in the Prophet ﷺ. So because the Prophet ﷺ done it, we do it. Even when there's not that reason. The mushrikeen are not looking at us anymore. We took over Mecca, right? Muslims got Mecca now. No one's looking at us, but because of the Prophet ﷺ done it, we do it. And no questions asked. And this is something that Faida that Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala mentions. So when a person finishes their tawaf now, the person who's done, who's mufrid, who's doing only hajj, meaning he's not doing umrah, he has a choice now to do sa'i or not. If he wants to do sa'i between Safa and Marwa, then he can count this sa'i for his sa'i al-ifadah. For his sa'i, meaning his wajib. You know, we mentioned the rukn, the pillar of hajj is to do sa'i as well and tawaf. Then this sa'i will be counted as his sa'i al-ifadah if he wants. But his tawaf is not considered tawaf al-ifadah. His tawaf is considered tawaf al-qudum only, which is the wajib. And as for the sa'i, then it is considered the sa'i of the hajj, sa'i al-hajj. And also the qarin, also the person who's doing qiran. As for the person who's doing tamattu', then his ihram right now is only for umrah. He's not in the state of hajj at all yet. He's still doing umrah, right? So his sa'i that he's going to do now is only for his umrah. Therefore, this person who is in the state of tamattu', they have to do a sa'i and another sa'i after when they go into the state of hajj, the ihram for hajj, the second ihram, they have to do another sa'i for this. But the person who's in the state of qiran, who's only doing, whose ihram is for hajj and umrah, and the person who's in the state of ifrad, whose ihram is for hajj only, then they are allowed to do sa'i for hajj now. So this is the eighth day, or this is the day, sorry, that they entered into Mecca, their sa'i for hajj is now complete if they do that. And the sa'i, when a person finishes tawaf, then, sorry, we forgot to mention one thing, which is the raka'atain. You pray two raka'ah behind the maqam of Ibrahim. Two raka'ah behind the maqam of Ibrahim is something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us to do after every single tawaf, whether it be a tawaf for hajj or for umrah, or just a sunnah tawaf where a person is in Mecca and he wants to do tawaf. It is recommended for him, according to the majority of the ulama, to pray two raka'ah behind maqam Ibrahim. And the maqam Ibrahim is right next to the Kaaba. And now obviously, because it's very difficult for a person to do that, then it's allowed for you to pray these two raka'ah anywhere around Mecca, in the haram, or even anywhere inside Mecca, or even outside Mecca. Yani it's allowed, so it was narrated from some of the companions, that they prayed these two raka'ah from near Medina. Near Medina they will pray these two raka'ah. And according to the Hanafiya, it is wajib to pray these two raka'ah. It is obligatory after every tawaf to pray these two raka'ah according to the Hanafiya. And it is sunnah for a person to recite in the first raka'ah, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ and قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. And then they come up, they stand up and they go to do sa'i. And a person, when they go to do sa'i, it is recommended for them to say, when they see Safa and Marwa, to read the ayah, إِنَّ الصَّفَى وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ فَمَنْ حَجَّ الْبَيْتَ أَوْ اِعْتَمَرَ فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِ أَنْ يَطَّوَّفَ بِهِمَا فَمَنْ تَطَوَّعَ خَيْرًا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ شَاكِرٌ عَلِيمٌ. It is recommended for them to read this ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam done this. And some of the scholars, they say, no, the Prophet ﷺ only done this because he was asked a question. He was asked, do we start from Safa or Marwa? So he says, نَبْدَأُ كَمَا بَدَأَ اللَّهُ بِهِ. We start as Allah started with. And that is, so he read the ayah to teach the people, إِنَّ الصَّفَى وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ. الصَّفَى and Marwa is from the symbols of Allah. So you start from Safa. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ read the ayah according to some ulama. So some ulama say it's not sunnah to read it. And some say it is sunnah to read it at the beginning. And these two aqwal are the strongest, and the third opinion, which is to read it in every single time. You start a Safa and you read it, Marwa, you read it. And that's the, according to Shaykh Salih, so he said this is the weakest opinion, Wallahu A'lam. So now a person, and we said that a person in Tawaf must be in the state of Tahara, he has to be pure, meaning he has to have wudu. And he has to be not in the state of Janaba. And also they have to be pure in their clothes. Their clothes have to be pure. As for Safa and Marwa, then this is recommended. Mean it is not wajib for a person to have this wudu in Safa and Marwa. So, for a woman who does tawaf, for example, and then they pray two rak'ah, and then their period comes at that time. Are they allowed to do tawaf, sa'i? Yes. But if their period comes before tawaf, then they're not allowed to do tawaf, and they have to wait and do it later. So a person now does saf, between Safa and Marwa, they start at Safa, and they face the Kaaba, and they make the dua, and they say, Allah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allah, Alhamdulillah, الذي أنجز وعده ونصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب وحده لا إله إنه says لا إله إلا الله وحده أنجز وعده ونصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب وحده and then he makes a dua and he makes a dua between that he says لا إله إلا الله وحده ولا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير لا إله إلا الله وحده أنجز وعده ونصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب وحده and he makes another dua and then he says again لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير لا إله إلا الله وحده أنجز وعده ونصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب وحده and he makes another dua and that's sunnah for a person to go on top of Safa and make face the Kaaba and make this dua then from Safa they go to Marwa and they walk and between the two green lights which are placed today the men they run they do a ramal which is they walk faster and this is specifically for the men and not for the women and Ibn Munzir rahimahullah ta'ala quotes ijma' consensus that this is only for the men and not for the women And they go to Marwa and they do the same thing. They face the Kaaba and they make the dua. لا إله إلا الله وحده لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير. لا إله إلا الله وحده أنجز وعده ونصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب وحده. And you make a dua. And you say that three times and you repeat it three times because this was the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم done. So when you finish the Safa and Marwa, the person when a person finishes the Safa and Marwa, then they are in two states. Either they done the Umrah. So they don't get mutamatti', so then they shorten their hair and they leave the state of ihram completely. So their umrah is done, and then they come back and they can do whatever they want. They can wear their normal clothes and they wait until Hajj, which is the 8th day of the Hijjah. And the second person is the person who's doing ifrad, and the person who's doing ifrad, they are now the qarin, and the qarin, this person, they stay in the state of ihram because this sa'i was for ihram of Hajj and Umrah. The sa'i and tawaf was for the tawaf was for Umrah and the sa'i was for Hajj and the Umrah. And they stay in the state of ihram until the 8th day of Dhul Hijjah, which is known as Yawm al-Tarwiyah. And so that's the whole chapter that we just summarized as a person who starts the ihram. When they enter into Mecca. And the next chapter is فَصْلٌ فِي حُكْمِ الْإِحْرَامِ بِالْحَجِّ يَوْمِ الثَّامِنِ وَالْخُرُوجِ إِلَى مِنَا Then the Shaykh رحمه الله تعالى talks about the 8th day of Dhul Hijjah. And this is the day where the people, the guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they enter into, they start their Hajj. The duyuf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who came from around the world to do the Hajj, every single one of them, they should start the Hajj on this day. And for those people who are qarin and mufrid, they stay in the ihram. And for those people who are mutamatti'in, they were doing tamattu', then they finish the ihram for umrah, then they enter into the ihram for the hajj on the 8th day of Dhul Hijjah. On the 8th day, this is the 8th day of Dhul Hijjah. So he says, فَصْلٌ فِي حُكْمِ الْإِحْرَامِ بِالْحَجِّ يَوْمِ الثَّامِنِ وَالْخُرُوجِ إِلَى مِنَا So he says the ruling for the person who's in the ihram to do the ihram for Hajj on the 8th day and going to Mina. So he says فَإِذَا كَانَ يَوْمُ التَّرْوِيَةِ on the day of Tarwiyah and the 8th day is called يَوْمُ التَّرْوِيَةِ and the reason why they call it يَوْمُ التَّرْوِيَةِ is because the Hujjaj on that day they were preparing for these next 5 days of Hajj or the 6 days of Hajj that they're going to be doing and they collect all the water that they need. So يَرْوُونَ الْمَاءِ يَرْوُونَ الْمَاءِ يعني يَرْوُون which is they take all the water and they fill themselves up with water they get the water so that's why it's called يوم التروية the day where the people, the حجاج they get ready for the Hajj so this day now is the first day of Hajj and this whole day is Sunnah this whole day is Sunnah I mean if a person completely forgets this day leaves this day off then the Hajj is still going to be correct And the acts that the person has to do in this day is number one, as ihram. They go into the state of ihram. And it is sunnah for the person to go into the state of ihram after zawal, after the sun passes midpoint. Because this is what the Prophet ﷺ had done. This is sunnah. And the second thing that they do is they pray the 5 salawat from Dhuhr and Asr and Maghrib and Isha and Fajr. They pray it. separately at its prescribed times, but shortened. So they pray Dhuhr 2 rak'ah, and Asr 2 rak'ah, and Maghrib 3 rak'ah, because you never shorten Maghrib, and Isha 2 rak'ah, and you pray Fajr 2 rak'ah like normal at its prescribed times. And these are the things that a person will do on Yawm al-Tarwiyah. I will read what the Shaykh says. فإذا كان يوم الترويه وهو الثامن من ذي الحجة استحب للمحلين بمكة ومن أراد الحج من أهلها الإحرام بالحج من مساكنهم لأن أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أقاموا بالأبطح وأحرموا بالحج منه يوم الترويه عن أمره صلى الله عليه وسلم ولم يأمرهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يذهبوا إلى البيت فيحرموا عنده أو عند الميزاب وكذا لم يأمرهم بطواف الوداع عند خروجهم إلى منى ولو كان ذلك مشروعا لعلمهم إياه والخير كله في اتباع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه رضي الله في اتباع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه رضي الله عنهم ويستحب أن يغتسل ويتنظف ويتطيب عند إحرامه بالحج كما يفعل ذلك عند إحرامه من الميقات وبعد إحرامه بالحج يسن لهم التوجه إلى منى قبل الزوال أو بعده من يوم التروية ويكثر من التلبية إلى أن يرموا جمرة العقبة ويصلون بمنى الظهر والعصر والعصر والمغرب والعشاء والفجر والسنة أن يصلوا كل صلاة في وقتها قصرا بلا جمع إلى المغرب والفجر فلا يقصر إلا المغرب والفجر فلا يقصران ولا فرق بين أهل مكة وغيرهم. And so he mentions مسألة هي. He says لا فرق بين أهل مكة وغيرهم. There's no difference between the people of Mecca in terms of shortening the salah.